Let's Talk is brought to you by the StarQuest Production Network and is made possible by our many generous patrons. If you'd like to support the podcast, please visit sqpn.com/give.
You're listening to Let's Talk, episode 54, brought to you by the StarQuest Production Network. Howdy all, Father Corey Stika. Welcome to Let's Talk, our SQPN community podcast. Glad you can join us. We've got actually three panelists this week. We're moving up. You know, usually we just have myself and two others, but we got three this week. First, we'll start with our returning panelists. Joanne Mercier is back with us. How's it going, Joanne?
Doing well. Hi, everybody.
And Steve Nelson is also with us. How's it going, Steve?
I'm doing well. I'm glad to be here tonight.
Well, very good. And we've got a third panelist who's new. Jay, why don't you introduce yourself to our listeners?
My name is Jay Anderson. I live in Norwalk, Ohio. I'm originally from East Texas and spent several years in Virginia before moving to Ohio about 13 years ago. I'm father of four kids, two boys and two girls, and lucky husband of one wife. And getting ready to go on vacation for 2 weeks starting tomorrow.
Oh, that sounds like fun. Where are you heading?
First, we're going to head down to Mount Vernon. Going to spend 3 days, spend the night, three nights at in a hotel there around Mount Vernon, and going to be at Mount Vernon on the 4th of July. Nice. And we're heading down to the Outer Banks for a week.
Oh, that sounds like fun.
Nice.
Yeah,
that sounds like a lot of fun. Well, you also have a kind of interest in history, and that's why we invited you to come on, because of course, as Jay mentioned, it is the 4th of July coming up here this week. And so I thought it'd be a good time to reflect on the Revolutionary War. And of course, the 4th of July celebrates our independence from Great Britain. So Jay, why don't you just kind of put you on the spot here, but because you do have interest in history. For those who maybe aren't as familiar with the Revolutionary War as we probably should be for us in the United States, or for people outside the United States who might not know about much about a Revolutionary War, why don't you kind of give the 5-minute thumbnail, if you will, of the Revolutionary War?
Wow. 5 minutes.
Give or take.
Well, way to put them on the spot.
Exactly. Like I said, yeah.
Well, the Revolutionary War, let's see, started in 1775 with the battles of Lexington and Concord. It lasted for 8 years till 1783. A lot of people think it ended after Yorktown in 1781, but it dragged on for another 2 years while the peace was being negotiated, and some interesting things happened in those 2 years, including some near coups that were Washington's officers got a little antsy about being paid and thought about rebelling against the Congress and marching to Philadelphia, and Washington adeptly put a stop to that. So in between those 8 years, obviously there were not a lot of fighting. There was a good bit of fighting early on. And mostly in the north. By 1778, 1779, the fighting moved to the south, where it was a really bitter civil war, America's first civil war, if you will. As loyalists and patriots really fought a bitter fight down there with reprisals and burning houses and slaughtering families. It was just really a nasty event in the South. And that lasted, you know, from 78 through 81. And then, you know, like I said, in 82 and 83, the war kind of kept dragging on after Yorktown. And I mentioned Washington putting an end to a potential coup. I don't know. What else do you want to know about the American Revolution? There, it spans a long 8 years with in various theaters of the country, from the New England to upstate New York to the Hudson Valley to the middle colonies or middle states in Pennsylvania, New Jersey, and then down in the southern states to kind of end up. So,
well, no, I think that's kind of a good oversight. I mean, admittedly, you know, I really didn't have an idea that it had lasted that long. You know, I think, I don't know, Joanne and Steve, I don't know what your impressions were growing up when you learned about it in U.S. history, what the war was like.
I think I learned mostly about the figures, you know, the who people were and what they fought for, other than the length of it. The length caught me on there, too, because I think everybody knows the Civil War was like 5 years. If I'm right there, good. But I didn't realize that the Revolutionary was 8. See, my people were fishing and farming in the Azores. We are, I have no ties to any kind of DAR or, you know, people who were here at that time. So when I learned about the Revolutionary War, I was in amongst an immigrant group that was very appreciative to be in a country that fought for its independence and fought for democracy. And that was pretty much the way it was bent when I was learning this many years ago. So I see it as a great thing and something that should be continued to be learned.
Yeah. How about you, Steve?
Well, I think, you know, the basics they teach in school sort of glamorize the high points and the key figures. And they don't really talk about the dirty side of the war, what Jay mentioned, the Southern campaigns and those kind of things, because it doesn't paint a very pretty picture of the whole situation. So, but it's, you know, I think everybody should read about it and learn about it. And, I've certainly have studied it over time and understand some of the political considerations and the whole idea of breaking away from a monarchy and, you know, starting a republic, a democratic republic and all that. That's what really fascinates me is all the key figures and the founding fathers that put together, you know, a government that has really sustained the test of time. Of course, we're talking constitutional, we're talking after this, but yeah.
Mm-hmm. Right, exactly. And yeah, I can agree with both of you that, you know, mine was, we're the good guys, Britain was the bad guys, George Washington and Ben Franklin and all of those, you know, all those figures that were involved in the founding of our nation and are important figures for the founding of the United States. But it really didn't get into a lot of the nitty gritty of the battles themselves, of the war itself, other than we had this war and it went tough for us for a while, but we finally won, kind of thing. And I think it's probably about as deep as it got into. Now, Jake, what led George Washington and company to decide, you know what, we need to break away from Britain? What was the impetus of that?
Well, it's a long train of abuses, I think, is what is what the Declaration says. You know, it started really shortly after the 7 Years' War, what we called the French and Indian War, as it was fought on the North American continent. Great Britain was broke after fighting this war against France and needed to raise some revenue. And they did something that up until then they hadn't done, which was directly tax the colonies from Parliament. The colonies saw themselves as having their own sovereign parliaments. Each colony had a general assembly or a legislature, and they saw those those colonial assemblies as their parliament with the power to tax, and did not see that they saw themselves as answerable to the sovereign, to the king, at that time King George III. They didn't see themselves as answerable to Parliament. And so direct taxation from Parliament, beginning really in 1765 with the Stamp Act, and then some subsequent acts after that, the Townshend duties. Of course, one of the big taxes was that we all know about was the tax on tea, which led to the you know, the notorious Boston Tea Party. And it was the British response to the Boston Tea Party that really kind of reached the breaking point with the colonies. And they passed what were known as the Intolerable Acts in the colonies. And one of them was they closed the port of Boston. Parliament put all these restrictions. They were quartering troops. They did not allow if someone were, let's say a British officer were being tried for a crime, they couldn't be tried in the colonies, which was sort of insulting to the colonies, because, you know, in 1770 was the Boston Massacre, so-called. And these British soldiers who were put on trial for murdering the citizens of Boston, and they were defended by John Adams. And John Adams, who went on to become one of the most vocal patriots in favor of independence, they were defended and for the most part acquitted of the crime of murdering the people that were killed during the Boston Massacre. So it's sort of insulting to the Americans to think that they couldn't be trusted to have fair trials here in America, that people were going to go back to Great Britain for trials. So all of these things that were done to the colony of Massachusetts specifically, the other colonies kind of looked around and said, hey, that could be us. And they formed associations. They all got together. They had the First Continental Congress. There were associations that would boycott the importation of British goods, and they were fairly successful at joining together and boycotting Great Britain and forming political associations like the First Continental Congress, and then eventually there was the Second Continental Congress that was set to meet in Philadelphia. They hadn't started meeting yet when basically April of 1775 rolled around, and we know what happened with Lexington and Concord. And that was the atmosphere in which the Second Continental Congress started meeting in Philadelphia.
I always thought that, and Jay, you know, tell me if I'm wrong, is that there were three colonies that sort of had the biggest vested interest, and they sort of drug the rest along. And I'm thinking of Virginia, New York, and Massachusetts. And that they had like the strongest political figures, and they sort of convinced everybody else to come along. It took some talking, took some time, but it seemed like those three are the ones that sort of led the charge.
South Carolina also had, surprisingly, you would think that South Carolina, with their ties to the transatlantic trade, that they would have been more loyalist. And in fact, down in the Low Country of South Carolina, some of the most radical people in favor of independence, or at least of pushing back against what Great Britain was doing through their taxation policy.
That was a trait that lasted quite a while, all the way to the Civil War.
Well, it's interesting too when you think of the colonies wanting to declare independence. It's not like every single person in the colony immediately rose up and said, yes, we want to break off. I mean, many colonies, it was very deeply split. And I would almost imagine that there are probably some colonies where it was, if not 50-50 for to stay or to leave, it may have even been a majority who wanted to stay, but were influenced by the other colonies.
Well, at first, the Continental Congress sent Britain an olive branch petition. They didn't. That wasn't the original idea when they met in 1775 to break away from Great Britain, to declare independence. They really wanted to reassert their rights as British citizens and to say, you don't have this power over us. We know that under the British Constitution, unwritten as it may be, we have the right to tax ourselves, and we are not answerable to Parliament. So for the first year of the war, arguably the Continental Congress was trying to resolve those differences while still maintaining troops in the field and even invading Canada at one point. So, you know, I think you're right that there was not this big move from the very beginning towards independence, and that some of the colonies did indeed have to be dragged along. Now, what I think where the Patriots were successful was early on in all 13 colonies, they got control of the state governments. By hook or by crook, either they were elected or they just seized control. They deprived the crown of any power within each of the 13 colonies. The royal governors were chased out. Guys like Lord Dunmore in Virginia, for example, basically tried to govern Virginia from a ship out in the Chesapeake Bay, and that didn't work, obviously. So. So that was where the Patriots really were successful early on. That happened in South Carolina as well, where basically the most radical among the leadership in the state sort of took the initiative and seized it and asserted asserted the Patriot cause. And so by 1776, after they submitted the Olive Branch petition, after King George had not even read it, and in fact went before Parliament and declared the colonies in open rebellion and declared that they were seeking their independence, despite the fact that they had sent this Olive Branch petition, these things started to kind of build up, and by May, June 1776, there was probably a majority in most of the colonies for independence.
Very interesting. Now, oh, go ahead.
I was going to say, you do know that 1776 and parts of Hamilton are going through my head right now.
Hey, I'm thinking about Hamilton. I'm also thinking about the musical 1776, where John Adams is, cajoling and really trying to win over the rest of the delegates for independence.
Yeah, well, you do realize that in that musical, you do see the splits within the colonies themselves, mm-hmm. because, somebody's always abstaining courteously. And I think it was the New York delegation that was split. So that goes to at least the historical background that they used for the musical.
I always find it interesting, too, that they really never asked the people what they thought. There was never a vote. It was all done by the delegates and by the local governments that just decided this was the course of action without asking anybody else.
They did the same thing with the Constitutional Convention.
Seems we have a long history of that.
Yeah. Well, there's I think that's a history in a lot of countries of the governed do the governing and the people just kind of, well, as long as I'm happy and fed, okay. And I know there was the time of the Revolutionary War was difficult for the average person as well because of the issues with the taxation and things like that. But I wonder how much it really would have affected your average rank and file resident of the colonies versus, we think of the people who were the leaders of the colonies. They were people, frankly, with land and money.
Yeah,
that's what I think.
The taxes weren't even all that high. When you look at them, and in fact, right before the Boston Tea Party, Great Britain had actually imposed a smaller tea tax, but they had, I think basically they created a monopoly for the East India Trading Company. And so what the colonies, a lot of what they were doing, they were rebelling over the principle more so than over the actual hit to their pocketbooks.
I heard a joke one time about how, the war would have ended a lot sooner if it had been the Boston Rum Party and not the Boston Tea Party.
Living in New England, as I do in Rhode Island, actually, I get to see all of these historical places all the time. And as a child and also as a teacher, I visited these places many times. So you get to see and hear the stories over and over again. about independence and revolution and how that, you know, how that shaped our country. I think people living in other parts of the country who don't see that probably forget. See, I'm in it. I can't walk by a place in downtown Providence or in downtown Boston that isn't historical right. in one way or another.
Right. Well, that's where I live. You know, I live in Montana, western part of the United States. There really isn't written history before about 1850 or so. Well, 1814 with Lewis and Clark, 1814 to 1816. That's the first history written. Of course, there's history from before that with Native Americans having been here for millennia, but the actual written history that we can go back and look at, you know, like our battlefields are like Custer's Last Stand, Little Bighorn Battlefield down by Billings, and we've got Chief Joseph's Last Stand over south of Chinook, not that far from here, actually. You know, but that's all late 1800s, you know. The history we're talking about is 100 years before that, and that's still young when you talk about Europe, where they measure history in millennia, not centuries.
Well, where I live in Oklahoma, it pretty much starts about 1830, when the Native Americans were forced to move here. So, I recently found out that I have a family connection to the Continental Army, and there's a lack of records that's kind of preventing me from finding out. But two different branches of my dad's family, if you work back far enough, they were both in the same Connecticut regiment. One was just a common soldier, and the other was a captain who was probably known by George Washington. And I kind of wonder if they ever knew each other. You know, there was a big cultural divide there or a class divide there. But I'd love to find out more, but you know, there weren't a lot of records kept on other than, you know, who was in what regiment, that kind of thing, but not much before or after it about those individual people.
Well, if you're really serious about that, I would say, you know, being the genealogist among you, I would go to American Ancestors, which is the New England Historic Genealogical Society's website, and they have a lot of those early records. That if you've got the documentation and you can trace it back far enough, they're doing something now for in 2020 for Plymouth, because that's going to be the big 400th anniversary. Just a commercial for them.
Yeah, exactly. Well, it is interesting. I know people have done that tracing back with their families and, you know, follow these records and everything, but there really isn't a lot of records from that time. Not like we would expect it today, is there?
Well, if you're going to compare to what we have today, the answer is no. They're smaller. But I believe places like, you know, American Ancestors and such are starting to put them all together in one place, because people are so interested in genealogy right now that there's a place at least you can go to look them up. You know, you're not going to find them everywhere, but you'll find them in certain spots.
Yeah. And so, another good place to look is in pension records. And you can find those sometimes on Fold 3, which is a website for military genealogical research. There is a couple of my ancestors were actually in the South Carolina militia. And they had pension applications that – well, my sixth great grandfather, Bailey Anderson, did a pension application in 1833. So almost 50 years after the war had 50 years after the war had ended, he was still around. And there are a lot of these pension applications, and they had to tell what their involvement in the war was. And so you can get a lot of information if you have an ancestor that happened to live long enough to do one of these things. You can get a lot of information from just their description of what they did in the war to prove that they were deserving of a pension.
Yeah, because these applications are not just what's your name, what's your rank. It's almost like an oral history.
Yeah, they're a treasure trove of information about battles, about people. You know, they'll mention who their captains were, who their generals were, who their colonels were, that sort of thing. And you know, I've been able to, through my sixth great grandfather's application really kind of put together a timeline and trace out, you know, what he did from the very beginning of the war to the very end of the war. And he was, you know, he was in it from, I don't know, to probably not until 1783, but certainly from 1775 to 1781. And he talks about all the things he did and who his commanders were. And you can cross-reference that stuff. You can look it up to see, okay, was that guy really there? And sure enough, they, in his case anyways, he's 50 years after the fact, when he's 80 years old, he still remembered enough details that you could put, you know, you could put together a really good timeline of his service. So
that's incredible. So now that we looked at the history, what I want to kind of bring it to, you know, modern day. When we talk about the Revolutionary War, you know, that was 236 years ago. Why is that important to study today? Why is that important for us as Americans? You know, yeah, we've got the 4th of July and we enjoy our Independence Day, hot dogs and hamburgers and fireworks. But why is it important to take time to learn about the Revolutionary War, learn the behind the scenes war? Why do you guys think, and throw that out there?
Well, what I would say is one of the key battle cries was for liberty, which is freedom from an oppressive government. And we still see that happening all over the world today, you know, in different forms. But, you know, we've been able to stave off any sorts of coups or any kind of takeovers or anything. And we've defended our liberty. And I think that serves as an example to what other governments, other peoples around the world can aspire to, because there's so many governments out there that do not provide their citizens the types of freedoms that we have.
I think we need to keep reminding ourselves why this country was founded, you know, on what principles, on what reasons did they come here, and what do they want to set up as a society? Because I think a lot of people purport they know that and try nowadays to say, well, you know, the Constitution shouldn't say this, or our founding fathers meant this, but not really. You really need to go back and see what they were trying to set up. And some people have said that this is a 236-year experiment. And it might be, because all kinds of things are now being constitutionally challenged. So I think the only way you're going to know where we are now is if you know why we started in the first place and where we were.
And I would say, because it's really the moment that defines us as a country. I mean, a lot of people would say that about the Civil War, because we had, you know, the brother against brother. We finally, you know, ended slavery with the 13th, 14th, and 15th Amendments, kind of came full circle with where the founding should have been. But I really think it's the American Revolution that defines us. If you look at all of the conflicts that we've had throughout our history, I mean, they're all right there encapsulated in the American Revolution. You've got liberals, you've got conservatives, you've got moderates. You've got the issue of race with Native Americans, who mostly sided with the British, although there were a few tribes that sided with the Patriot cause. But, you know, and then you have the issue of slavery, and just how stark, you know, that just the, it, you know, it's just a stark reminder that here we were fighting for freedom, and yet we were holding other human beings in bondage. And you know, and the British recognized this, that it was, you know, that there was some inconsistency there. And, you know, twice a British commander issued basically an Emancipation Proclamation, you know, 80 years or more before Abraham Lincoln ever did. You had Lord Dunmore issued one in Virginia. And if you look at the reaction to that, it really angered. It angered Washington, and it angered a lot of the colonial leaders that Dunmore would do this, because they looked at it as, wait a minute, you're supposed to be, you know, our sovereign, you know, representing our sovereign here on our soil, and you're riling up the enslaved people that we're holding to rebel against us, to kill us in our sleep, to, you know, do that sort of thing. So it was, you know, that issue of slavery and race and, you know, a treatment of the Native Americans, that's all right there in the American Revolution. I mean, the big losers of the American Revolution and then later the War of 1812 were the Native American populations. They sided with Britain in both instances. And when both of the wars were over, Britain didn't keep their promises to the natives. The land they ceded to the United States at the end of the Revolutionary War was land they had promised to keep, you know, to give to the natives if they won. And when they lost, they gave the United States ceded all the land all the way to the Mississippi River, which there's where Oklahoma comes into play. There was nowhere else for them to go at that point but across the river. So these issues that have really kind of haunted us throughout our history of race and political divide. I mean, even after the war was over, you know, when you're creating a new nation, you're establishing a constitution, and you've got on the one hand Washington and Hamilton, and on the other hand you've got Jefferson and Madison, and you know, basically the Federalist Party and the, at that time was called the Republican Party, but which eventually became the Democratic Party. The Federalists are often looked at, you know, at least early on, kind of as they became, you know, when that party folded, then the Whig Party was founded. Then when the Whigs folded, the Republican Party was founded. So, you know, all of these tensions that we've experienced as a nation were right there from the beginning. And it's just, I think it's a compelling story. And, just the conflict and the people's living in conflict. What happened to the Loyalists? You know, they lost their homes. And basically you've got the founding of Canada. You know, that's not exactly what happened, but that's where a lot of the Loyalists went, was up to Canada. So you've got, you know, these people living in crises and with all this tension, and we still are living it today. I'm sorry, that's a long run-on explanation for why I think studying the war is important, but I think that's that's the best explanation I can give.
Well, you know, Abraham Lincoln in the Gettysburg Address throws it right back and says we're still trying to decide if a government conceived the way we did is going to survive or not. And that was 87 years later.
Yeah. And it was a lot of history between then and now, and we're still trying to figure it out, I think.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Well, one thing you mentioned too was with Canada, is I've always been struck by that. Of course, living so close to Canada, you know, our cultures are similar. You know, we more or less speak the same language other than Quebec, but I think even Canadians don't consider them real Canadians. No, I'm kidding. Just kidding. But we speak the same language. Our cultures are very similar. You know, it's very easy, relatively speaking, to cross from here into Canada and vice versa. But yet our interactions with Great Britain are very different, at least at the founding of our nation, because, of course, again, we had the Revolutionary War. We split away by force, basically, whereas Canada was, Great Britain just basically said, okay, we're going to make you a separate nation now. You know, just taking a longer story short, but I mean, Canada had much more amenable separation from Great Britain than we did. I just think that was kind of interesting that, and you kind of hinted that. I wonder if our Revolutionary War kind of gave that impetus for Canada to then eventually split off.
Well, the one thing I know from genealogical research, because my husband is French Canadian, is that they were having their own problems up there, and they were trying to drag the colonies into their own war, because at one point the British threw the French out of Canada and they ended up coming into New England. The colonies didn't want them, so then they end up in Nova Scotia. They throw them out of Nova Scotia. So there's a lot of migratory patterns going on in there in genealogy. So I've learned a little bit about that. So at the same time we were trying for independence, the British seemed to be divided because they were also trying to get their house in order up in Canada.
Well, and a bunch of them, I think, also ended up down in Louisiana, because that was still, I believe, still French controlled at the time.
Mm-hmm. And Detroit and places along the Mississippi. The French were very good at navigating rivers. So they were doing that sort of migratory pattern for a long time, almost into the 20th century, especially here in New England, where they would go up and down the rivers. They would come down the river to Connecticut, work here, Connecticut and Rhode Island, and then they'd go back up to Canada by the river to bring the money home and maybe have it. And what they would do is they would have a child here, a child up there, a child in here. Finding them is hard sometimes as to where they were born, yep. because they were born all over the place. But again, Canada was a whole other kettle of fish at the same time we were looking for independence.
Mm-hmm. By the way, in case you'll hear it on the recording and you probably hear it again now, I've got a thunderstorm going on outside right now, a nice one. So you'll hear rumble and grumble from my end.
Oh, nice.
Sorry, I got distracted by my thunderstorm, but it's interesting to see the differences, and it really kind of strikes me. And it's funny too, again, looking back at our history, looking back to the Revolutionary War, and then looking at our relationship with Great Britain now. You know, in the year 1800, in 1819, you know, just a mere 200 years ago, we would definitely have not called Great Britain our greatest ally, our best friend. Yet now I think it's pretty much it's pretty much in a mutual agreement that on both sides that we're each other's best friends, so to speak, as countries, you know? And so it's interesting how that relationship has really healed itself. Although I love the Facebook memes of, you know, happy Independence Day. I hate that when I blink.
Happy Traitors Day.
Traitors Day. There we go. Yeah. Happy Independence Day. Happy Independence Day, you traitors. That's what I was trying to say.
Well, all I keep hearing again is King George's song and Hamilton, we'll be back, you know, and it's sort of kind of, are we back? Because now we have an American married into the royal family.
Yeah.
You know, that would never have happened.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, I don't think that either country wanted a total separation after the revolution. There were too many ties that between the two countries and, you know, they were trying to work it out, I think. Yeah, the whole War of 1812 was a really weird war to begin with. But besides that, I think that there's been strong connections between the two countries. And they've never wanted to totally go their own separate ways, unlike a few of the other British parts of the British Empire that really did want to go their own way when they had a chance.
Yeah, well, that's true, because a lot of Americans can trace their lineage back to Great Britain.
Well, and like,
I mean, more so than they think so.
And like you said, Jay, it was originally the war wasn't started to break away. The war was started to say, we have rights as British citizens and we are going to do what we need to get those, keep those rights and protect those rights. And eventually it became, correct. No, we're just going to break away.
That's correct. Yes. I mean, fairly conservative revolution as revolutions go. I mean, yeah, it got bloody down in the South with the Loyalists and Patriots really having a civil war down there. But, you know, as far as revolutions go, it was a fairly conservative revolution. And I think the Constitution, if you look at the Constitutional Convention, that kind of cemented the revolution as a more conservative revolution. You had guys like Washington were the ones who were going to set the tone for the country, not the Sam Adamses or even the Jeffersons, who was a little more radical and certainly had ties to the French Revolution, which was anything but a conservative revolution. And I think that first decade of governance in Washington's administration, and then followed by the Adams administration, and certainly with the influence of Hamilton in setting up a financial system and setting up a system of trade, where we basically maintained our ties to Great Britain, much to the consternation of people like Jefferson and Madison, who wanted closer ties to France, even revolutionary France. And I think that one of the reasons that we didn't break away completely from Great Britain as far as our ties and our relationships with them is because of that first decade under Washington's administration and just sort of a more conservative transition from being colonies to a new nation, as opposed to a more radical transition. More, you know, it wasn't, it certainly there was a social aspect to the revolution, but it wasn't the big social revolutions that, say, Europe experienced in France and Soviet Union and then other places like that.
Well, it was definitely seen as a social revolution of sorts in England, because I know, or in Europe, because I know what the French Revolution was influenced very highly by our own. Sure. It was the fact that we had our revolution that led to the French. Of course, again, like you said, the two are night and day as far as, you know, the what happened during them. The French Revolution was as much a civil war as it was.
I hadn't thought about that. That
a
I
revolution.
To is so our revolution was against a remote government. You know, it was across the ocean in England. And when you think about, like, most revolutions, they're rebelling against a home government where they actually have a palace to go sack or a parliament to burn down or, you know, people like that. So everybody they were rebelling against in the U.S. was sort of in absentia. You know, all they had was the British Army, which was pretty potent. But, you know, they couldn't actually go and attack the king. Do you think that had a difference in the way that it came about?
I mean, I think so. I think in a sense, revolution is really kind of a misnomer when we talk about the Revolutionary War. It's you know, the British call it the American War for Independence. And that's probably a more accurate terminology. It was a war for independence, but that's not to say there weren't revolutionary aspects to it. And when I say it was more of a conservative and less, you know, conservative and not a social revolution, there were definitely some revolutionary aspects to it. I don't want to downplay the fact that there was a social upheaval. It just wasn't on the scale of what you would normally see in a revolution where it's the people sacking the palace and beheading the king and that sort of thing. It was more of a war for independence, but at the same time, it was revolutionary in the sense that it changed the world. I mean, the ideas, the Enlightenment ideas that formed the basis of the Declaration of Independence, the Constitution, the Bill of Rights, these are things that were revolutionary in the sense that it was a new way of thinking about one's relationship to one's government and as citizens instead of subjects. And so, you know, I don't want to downplay the revolutionary aspect, but as revolutions go, it was still the transition was far more conservative than what you normally see. There wasn't, you know, the reprisals and the, you know, certainly the loyalists lost out, and they picked up and moved for the most part. But you didn't see the same sort of social upheaval that you often see in European revolutions.
Was there anything kind of come to the time to move on, but is there anything else any of you would like to?
I'm just always been a big proponent of history, and you know, I really think there is value in learning, you know, every aspect of our own history that you can, even the bad parts. I mean, here we're in Oklahoma, where I live, we're still dealing with what's called the Tulsa Race Riots of the 1920s. And so we're coming up on an anniversary of that. And so it's a very, very painful, it's the darkest day in the history of our city. And, but yet I think there's value in studying that and learning it and discovering those truths. And so, you know, I don't think there's any downside to learning history, as long as you're honest about it.
I agree with you, Steve, because I think when you start to, and probably it's a bad term now, whitewash history, you only get the one side. And I think you need to see all sides, the good, the bad, and the ugly, to know what we've been through so you don't repeat it. And we are good at repeating history over and over again. So I think it would be good if we could continue to learn this stuff and learn it even with some of the mistakes right in front of us.
Gene?
Yeah, I would say take your kids, take your grandkids, visit these sites. I've done that with my own kids. We love to go to Revolutionary War sites. We've done it in New England. We've done it in New York. We've done it in the mid-Atlantic states. We've done it in the southern states. Any chance we get to travel, we go to visit these sites. And again, it's to not, I mean, I do want to instill in my children a sense of patriotism and a sense of pride in what their country, the principles the country was founded on. But at the same time, to recognize that we're not perfect and that, you know, there is tension there between the words and the ideas that we were founded on and how we have lived out those words. And, you know, and I really tried to teach them that history is not black and white. It's not, there's not a right side of history and a wrong side of history. I hate that terminology. You know, you're on the wrong side of history. No, there's not a right side and wrong side, except, you know, at the end of time, we'll find out who is on the right side and wrong side of history. But that history is nuanced and that there's, you know, there's good and bad in people. You know, Washington was a great man, but he owned slaves. You know, he sort of redeemed himself at the end by freeing his slaves in his will. But, you know, even with Washington, you know, he was also kind of a land hungry person. You know, he favored policies that expanded the United States when he was president, which meant somebody was going to be displaced. So you can look at this man who is arguably one of the greatest men in all of history. Certainly, I would argue the greatest man in United States history. But he wasn't perfect and he had faults. And to show my kids that, you know, there are two sides to all of these stories. I think that's an important way to teach history. And I think visiting the sites where you can really talk about it and walk the ground, I think plays a key role in that teaching.
Oh, very good. Some very good thoughts. And yeah, I encourage all listeners to learn more about these historical events, the history of the founding of our nation, because, you know, and echo kind of what we all said is, you know, we need to learn from it. We need to learn from it. We need to, you know, learn what does our country stand for? What was our country founded on? And yeah, we got to recognize it was founded by fallible human beings, because guess what? We're all fallible human beings, and we just need to learn what is good and try to root out what needs to be left behind in the dustbin of history. You know, our country does that too. So that's a good thing. And actually this would be a good time. We'll take a break before we go on to our picks of the week. But a good connection to this would be our new podcast here at SQPN, the American Catholic History Podcast. Tom and Noel Crow are talking about the American Catholic Church in the United States. I'm not saying we have an American Catholic Church. The Catholic Church in America is probably a better way to put that. But the history of Catholicism within our country. It's very interesting. They're very short, 10 minutes or less per episode. Just little snippets of history. So something to check out to celebrate our faith as it has been lived within our country over the last 240 years or so. So please do check that out. You can find that at sqpn.com along with all our podcasts, of course, all the other ones that we have that we've enjoyed doing so much. And of course, as we always do, I'd like to thank those who help keep SQPN on the air, so to speak, who contribute through our Patreon campaign to give us the help that we need so that we can keep the website up and keep the podcasts coming. You can find our Patreon campaign at sqpn.com/give and click the Patreon link. There you can join in helping every month give a little bit to keep our production going. This week I'd like to thank Bomta, Mark C, Alan, Melissa K, Maciel B, and John J. Thank you and all those who support our campaign, our Patreon campaign, to keep SQPN going. So now we'll switch over to our picks of the week, and I hope that Dom mentioned to you, Jay, about our picks of the week so that you're ready to go.
Well, he briefly mentioned that, you know, a book or something like that. Does it need to be pertinent to the topic we just spoke about? Well, I have something that is. my pick of the week then is, I'll even show a picture of it. The book that I'm reading right now is Rick Atkinson's The British Are Coming, The War for America, Lexington to Princeton, 1775 to 1777. It is, he's working on a trilogy called the Revolution Trilogy. And this is the first book of that. Rick Atkinson won the Pulitzer Prize for a previous trilogy that he did on the war in Europe. And so I'm hoping that he will do for the Revolutionary War what his previous trilogy did for the war in Europe. It's a very popular series of books. And I'm actually going to see Rick Atkinson at Mount Vernon on Thursday for the 4th of July and hoping to get him to sign my copy of the book. So that's my pick of the week. The British Are Coming by Rick Atkinson.
Very cool. Sounds interesting. Joanne, do you have a pick for us?
Yes, I do. I think I'll go with what I talked about earlier, which is AmericanAncestors.org, which is the website of the New England Historical Genealogical Society. If you are really seriously looking up your ancestors, and if they go back that far in the United States, this is the place to go and find. They have a Mayflower ancestry page because they're looking for all these people. They're associated with the Daughters of the American Revolution and the soldiers. I forget what the other one is. The male counterpart of that. It escapes my mind right now, but they're putting all of these things together. Plus, so if your people don't go back that far, if you live in New England, this is the premier place to find all of the historical records from the cities and towns in New England. Mm-hmm. And they now have the repository for the Archdiocese of Boston for all of the sacramental records. So if you're looking for somebody back in the 1700s or the 1800s, the only catch back there is it's not going to be, you know, if they lived in Milford, Mass, for example, Milford might not have been around in 1805.
Yep.
And they also might not be part of what is now the Worcester Diocese. So you have to really get your history going if you're going to go back and research that far. But I think that's a good thing because people need to be able to see, too, how we developed as a country. That if they're doing their genealogical research, part of that comes into play because the names now are not the names then. Mm-hmm. So I would go to AmericanAncestors.org.
Very good. Very good. Steve?
Well, since we're talking about the American Revolution, there are a couple of books that it's not real deep historical investigation, but I think it's helpful, and they have to do with the spy rings that helped George Washington get intel on what was happening. One of them is by Brian Kilmeade, who's, you know, a lot of people either like him or don't like him, depending on your politics. But he wrote a book called George Washington's The Secret Six, and it's kind of a fluff piece, but it does kind of help lay out some of the intricacies of what was happening. And then there's another book by Alexander Rose, which I think goes into a little bit deeper, historical examination of the topic. So I found the topic just really interesting that they were able to have these people that were willing to put their lives on the line to get intel against the British to help the American cause.
Oh, excellent. Excellent. Yeah. Well, I'm going to change it up. So you guys did actual topical picks of the week. I'm going to do something that is completely non-topical. In fact, it's only a couple of days old. So of course, people who know me know that I like video games sometimes a little too much. And Nintendo recently released Super Mario Maker 2. And I've grown up with the Super Mario series of games. I played Super Mario Brothers on my NES, on Super Mario World, and all the way up through. Well, the idea of the Super Mario Maker games, this is, like I said, the second one, the first one came out on the Wii U, this one's for the Switch, is you can build your own levels. You can build your own Super Mario levels and then share them on the internet and everybody throughout the world. And I've played levels from Japan and all over Europe and all over the United States. People will go and play them. It also has kind of a story mode where you do a bunch of different levels. Kind of the neat thing, again, for those of us who are fans of those series, you can make the levels look like whichever version of Super Mario you want. So you want a level that looks like the original Super Mario Brothers, you can. You want a level that looks like the latest and greatest with all the, 3D graphics, you can. Super NES version, whatever. So if you're a fan of Super Mario, you've probably already heard it. You probably already have it. But if you don't and you have a Nintendo Switch, check it out. It's a lot of fun. I have a feeling after I'm done editing this podcast, I will be playing. So anyways.
Gee, whatever gave me that idea.
Yeah. Well, this is my day off, so I can spend a little time playing. But well, it's a lot of fun. So check it out. So I had to go a little different there. Well, Jay, thank you very much for coming on. We very much appreciate it. Very interesting conversation. Is there is there some place where people could hear more from you if they'd like to?
Well, not really. I used to blog a long time ago. I'm on Facebook. Everything I post on Facebook is public. And I post some things on Twitter. I try to post a few historical items every day, mostly related to the Revolutionary War. But if you want to read more of what I have to say about the American Revolution, then probably following me on Facebook is the best way to do it.
Excellent. Steve.
Oh, you know, I'm like Jay, my blogs are gathering dust, but,
we keep putting you on the spot for that. I know.
Yeah, I know. You can look me up. Probably Facebook's the best place to go. And that's, facebook.com/SC Nelson.
Excellent. And Joanne.
Yeah, I'm still hanging around myself. none of us, we all hang around SQPN. But yep. I think Ritual Diva on Twitter. And I don't know, maybe the long forgotten podcast that I used to host will be having a resurrection soon. But maybe the next time I come on, I can talk more about that. But the one thing I will say is if you are listening to this before July 4th, Turner Classic Movies, guess what? They're playing all the movies you could stand for the American Revolution.
Oh, boy.
Yeah, including they're showing Yankee Doodle Dandy, 1776, and The Music Man.
Oh, there you go.
How that has anything to do with anything is a whole other story.
Yeah. Well, I'm Father Corey Stika. You can find my website, frcorey.org, where I post my homilies. My Facebook page is Father Corey Stika, and my Twitter handle is frcoreystika. If you have any feedback on this episode or any episode of Let's Talk, please send it to our email address is letstalk@sqpn.com. You can also comment on the Facebook post on the SQPN Facebook page or the YouTube post as well, where we post the audio to YouTube. Please do send feedback. We definitely want to hear what you think. Thank you very much for listening, and God bless.